kind introduction, and I feel honored to give an invited talk at STAX because I'm not really 100% from the theory community, so I have lacks in both areas, theory and practice, and so I'm particularly honored that people think that what I have to say may also be interesting for theoreticians. And I have tried to adapt the talk to this fact that I'm not talking to practitioners today. And also I think this is more than maybe other talks, a talk with a mission. I really think that the theory community or the algorithms community in general has partly missed a trend, and that it may be very interesting for some of you to listen to my arguments that maybe there are interesting research opportunities out there in the area of parallel processing in general and parallel algorithms in particular. So let me try to give you a very short, simplified history of parallel processing. Actually, if you could get back very early, even the stuff that was done during the Second World War was parallel in some sense. But until the 1970s, all of computer science, and in particular parallel computing, was a very new thing. There were some pioneering things, but not so much work done yet. And then in the 1980s, it became something of a hot topic in the theory community. Parallel algorithms was one of the biggest topics of all of them. If you look at the hardware at that time, there were very ambitious projects that now we would call exotic, like data flow machines, and very exciting in a sense, but not really usable yet, I would say. And then what happened in the 1990s was, from the point of view of parallel processing, a catastrophe. So there were lots of startups trying to build parallel machines, and all of them went bankrupt, really all of them. So some of them survived as part of bigger companies. Then Cray may be an exception. They were basically be rescued by American state-funded money. And what happened in the theory community and in the algorithms community at that time is that there was a rapid decline in the 1990s of work on that subject. And in the 2000s, say in the first decade of this millennium, it was practically dead. Towards 2007 or so, the hardware stuff began to change. Multicores were slowly showing up. And what we have now in the 2010s is that parallel processing is suddenly ubiquitous. There's exploding parallelism. Even a smartphone has 8-core processors right now. You have graphics processing units with that need tens of thousands of threads in order to work efficiently. You have cloud computing, you have big data applications that require massively parallel computing. And there are first traces that the algorithms community is noticing. There's a slow comeback, but I think it's much too slow, and I will try to explain why and why it's an interesting area. But let's first look at the reasons for the decline, and some of them you might think are also reasons for staying dead. So who really killed parallel processing is this guy, right? He was used in the Intel advertisement in the early 2000s. Most people perceived parallel processing as superfluous because you just wait a year and then your sequential computer is twice as fast because clock frequencies, automatic parallelization by instruction parallelism and so on were giving you enormous rates of performance improvement. And at the same time, the theorists were widely criticized for using unrealistic models like PRAMs, work inefficient algorithms, and so on. And overall, this had fairly little impact on practice. There were parallel machines, always, but they were exotic and very expensive and used mostly in numerical applications where there is only limited use for the results that we computer scientists are producing. And as I said, then what happened is that these specialized parallel computing companies went bankrupt. And then what may have been even worse for our community is that the internet boom produced a huge brain drain. Because suddenly there was a new area that, where people with some parallel background were quite qualified to work on. So lots of these people previously working on parallel computing were now moving either to the theory of World Wide Web and other things, or even to startups. Like the company Akamai was founded by people from algorithm theory, right? So what happened? Let's look at these reasons individually. So after, say, 2007 or so, waiting for faster processors didn't work anymore because processors didn't get any faster, or not much at least. The reason is that the power density of processors is so high now that it's close to a nuclear reactor. And you can't go very much farther. In particular, you can't increase clock frequency anymore. And you also can't do expensive things like speculative instruction execution and so on. To get performance out of Moore's law, which is still scaling right now, it's much easier to simply use multiple processing units on the same chip. But then you have to explicitly program this stuff in parallel. And that's called the power wall. Now, about this criticism of being impractical. Since then, the methodology of algorithm engineering has developed that allows us to closely integrate the work of an algorithm theorist and practical work so that we have more impact. And for the theory community, I just want to say that it doesn't mean that all of you have to implement, right? It's just thinking more about some practical aspects, simplicity, maybe constant factors, smooth complexity, and so on. And then there are lots of theoretical problems also involved in algorithm engineering. And then previously, parallel computers were exotic. So the exotic thing you see actually here, right? That's the fastest machine in the world. And that shows a rather steady increase in number of processors. Although it's going up and down a lot, and actually here, around the collapse of parallel algorithm theory, it also was going down because the exotic machines were dying out. But then, since actually the mid-90s already you have the graphics processors, which around here became general purpose processors actually, and then later also mainstream producers like Intel picked that up, and even their mainstream processors are now quite parallel, right? So now suddenly it goes from exotic to mainstream and big business. And the same thing happens for the brain drain, right? Even particular people who moved away to the internet stuff are now working on big data problems and suddenly have to do stuff in parallel. And of course, there's also a new generation of researchers who pick up these topics. So that was all of these reasons I mentioned, but you could still say, well, we did a really good job in the 80s and 90s. All the problems have been solved. Why do you want to warm that up? That's a reason I really hear very frequently. And of course, I, as a PC member or so, I often see such papers. But there's so much to be done that does not fulfill this criticism. One thing once more is the algorithm engineering stuff, because that's also a new methodology. And also if I look at theory, there are so many things like memory hierarchies, streaming algorithms, succinct data structures, fixed parameter algorithms. In the theory community, where most of the interesting work we are considering now happened after this late 90s collapse of parallel processing. And so you have to reconsider all of these problems in parallel. For example, the first talk I heard today, very nice talk on spanners by Kavita. You really also want to compute these spanner graphs in parallel because it's about big data, right? And if you want to really solve on the big data things, you have to look at parallel algorithms for that. And you can extend that to almost any question. And then there are also application areas that have motivated very interesting theoretical research that have also exploded since then, like bioinformatics, the World Wide Web stuff themselves, social networks, mobile applications. algorithmic game theory. And then even in the computing models, things have happened. So you now have exascale computing and cloud computing, where you really have to tolerate occasional faults of processors or communication. So you also have to look at fault-tolerant algorithms. And in many of these things, running time is no longer that important. We are more interested in energy consumption, and you get a completely new model here, which is also very interesting from a theoretical point of view. So I think, I could put four slides, like, but I want to do only one slide, and I guess I could talk with any of you, and in your area, if you work in algorithms, but also in complexity, I guess, one could find interesting questions. So here's another statistics I've made. The stock papers that somehow have something to do with parallel processing, very subjective, and you really see that it was a lot in 85. There was some fluctuations, but even until 2000, there was, even until 1995, there was a very big number, and then there was this rapid decline. This is a one, right? And that's probably Kirk Proust or something like that, right? Scheduling parallel machines. But not parallel algorithms in the more restricted sense that you actually have algorithms running in parallel. And now it seems to go up. So 6 and 4 in the last 2 years. I also saw Stacks. Now it has, I think, 4 papers that are related to parallelism. So also a slight revitalization. Okay, and now in the second part of my talk, I would like to give you a few concrete examples from the work of my group, because that's easy to explain, but it's not because I want to tell you how great I am. Maybe to the contrary. I want to tell you 3 very different examples where actually very simple and easy results answer very fundamental questions on parallel computing. And thereby I want to show that there is a lot of open ground here, that it's actually relatively easy to get very interesting fundamental results, and that probably this can be found everywhere, also in your area of research. So we have worked a lot on sorting. I will only shortly talk about this. I want to talk about communication-efficient algorithms in more detail, because that's, I think, quite nice. We have done parallel data structures. I will also not talk a lot about that. Then something from numerics, matrix inversion, one of the most fundamental problems. And there's a very simple algorithm that gives a significant improvement of previous work. And then, of course, I'm working a lot on graph algorithms. So even a slight generalization of Dijkstra's algorithm gives you a very interesting parallel algorithm for multi-objective shortest paths. And I've worked on matching, graph partitioning, lots of other things. If you are interested, we can talk about this. So what about the sorting stuff? Let me just name a few things and just give you a feeling for how fundamental the problems are. We have worked in 2010 on distributed memory parallel external sorting. And you can basically show matching upper and lower bounds for both communication volume and I/O complexity. And it turns out that a relatively standard algorithm with a number of tricks does the job. And that had quite some practical impact, because we were winning an important benchmark from the database community. And then in 2013, we started looking at string sorting. We actually wanted to do something else, namely full-text index construction. But then we noticed that there was almost nothing on parallel string sorting, and that we needed as a subroutine. So we found that basically all the basic algorithms, radix sort, quick sort, sample sort, multi-way merge sort, they have a string variance that's not completely obvious, but that needs some development, needs some proving of bounds. And we obtain very interesting practical algorithms there with reasonably interesting theoretical bounds. And I have lots of ideas actually for how to do stronger theoretical things that are somehow based on these, but that are of course more complicated. But I just didn't find the time because there's simply so many things you can do in this area. But if you are interested, we can discuss it. Now we are looking at massively parallel sorting, and there also was a gap between theory and practice. Very complicated theoretical algorithms and practical algorithms that clearly do not scale. And we just did very simple things and got orders of magnitude improvements for some cases. But I don't want to molest you with details of these sorting algorithms. For a theoretician, maybe more interesting is this model of communication efficient algorithms. I think it's, from a practical point of view and from the point of view of simplicity, the obvious model for modeling communication. And I had to learn that the communication complexity community does something very different, so that everything here from the point of view of lower bounds is open ground, because nobody worked on this model for lower bounds. For upper bounds, I will now give you a few results. So what's the obvious model in my opinion? So you have RAMs, random access machines, random access machines, say, independent sequential computers with local memory. And that's a model that in practice you have in a computing center where you have independent nodes. I mean, next to here we have the SuperMOOC, which has, I think, 10,000 such nodes or so. So they are really big machines. I think it's even more, right? Can anybody give me the number of the SuperMOOC? Doesn't matter. Right, and then there's a communication network, and then how do you measure communication complexity here? It should be somehow proportional to running time, right? And then what matters is a bottleneck communication, meaning the maximum number of bits or machine words that any of these nodes has to communicate over the network. And the exchange is point to point. You can't do broadcast for free, for example. And in this model, we are now analyzing and designing a lot of algorithms and also implementing them. Maybe let's compare that to other models. I already told you about lower bound stuff. There's also distributed streaming algorithms. They have a similar model, but similar to the lower bound people, they assume that there's a central one processor has to do all the communications with the rest, and they are working independently. But that's a huge scalability bottleneck, and the algorithms you get by this do not really scale for the big data applications we have in reality. There's another model which I like much more, that's parallel external memory or resource oblivious parallel computations or cache oblivious parallel models, which are very nice. But what I want to look at here cannot be modeled in these things, because what you have there is you have down here, you have a big shared memory and small caches here. And the input is in the big shared memory. And then it's impossible to have algorithms that take sublinear communication volume. But if you talk to the hardware people, that's what you need. Because for the really large machines, the network here is really the bottleneck. And in order to be scalable on large data sets, you have to use sublinear amount of communication. And you cannot model that in these parallel external memory models and the like. Right? And that's what I find very interesting. There's intensive work on all of these things. Probably hundreds of papers with these three areas that gave you, but they are all using the wrong model. And I know two papers on this model. Not really. I mean, I have written two papers on this. And there are other things that can be translated to this, but that's rather limited. So there's a huge open area here. But now let's get beyond advertising and looking into a concrete problem here. Right? First example, counting. Maybe the first massively parallel algorithm used in practice was elections, right? If you have a large country like India, you certainly do not ask everybody to show up in New Delhi and cast its ballot. cast its vote. Right. No, you have hundreds of thousands or even millions of voting places where you are locally counting votes. And then you take one scrap of papers with the counts and go to your next town. And there it's summed again. And they go to the region capital and so on. And then in principle, within a day, you could vote in a 1 billion people country, right? That's something that works already for decades. And it doesn't work in these models I discussed before. They all assume a centralized ballot. I don't understand that. Okay, but now for something non-trivial. A very popular data structure is an approximate dictionary that allows you membership queries that are approximate in some sense. Namely, there is a true answer if it says, oh, it's not in there, but there is a false positive probability. It may be that the data structure tells you, oh, it's in it, but it's not really there. And we'll tell you how to make this distributed in a scalable way. And then I will apply it to do duplicate detection. And actually, in this paper we have, we show that database join can be done in a very similar way. So that's what I already said about approximate membership queries. And let the false positive probability be F plus. And of course, that plays a big role in the discussion here. And we have N elements that take U bits each. And of course, an exact dictionary would need U times N bits. But what we want is M much less than U times N bits with a small false positive probability. That's the game here. So what's traditionally done there are Bloom filters. So we choose K hash functions. And for each element, the hash functions go from 1 to m. That's the number of bits I have available. And the hash functions tell us which bits we have to set to 1. Okay? And then one can compute that about m over n times ln2 hash functions are optimal for Bloom filters. That has thousands of citations, this data structure. And many of them actually for distributed applications, but none of them really scaling. That's very surprising for me. What we do is slightly different. We say, no, we do something stupid. We say, set k equals 1, right? Then the false positive probability is not that good. It's n over m. And it takes exponentially more space than Bloom filters. So really stupid, right? But no, it's not. Because this bit array here becomes very sparse. And if you compress it, we actually get something that's information theoretically optimal. And that's actually about 30% less than even optimal Bloom filters, right? That's a reasonably old, well-known result. And a side effect of this is that this is very easy to distribute. What we simply do is we take these M bits and spread them over the P processors we have. And then setting 1 bits involves 1 communication, right? I mean, that's not nice. We don't want to communicate, but it's k times better than what Bloom filters do. And I guess that this is actually the reason why nobody tried to do scalable Bloom filters, because this factor of k makes this immediately impractical. But with k equals 1, it's a very simple, practical, scalable, distributed data structure. Okay? And I mean, the problem here, of course, is you have to set 1 bit. That doesn't mean it's 1 bit of communication, right? Because you have to send an entire message saying, here, there's a message for this processor, and I want to set this bit. So that's at least log n bits, I guess. But you can compress this if you have batched operations. And many of the applications we have looked at use batching. And then if you have a batch of m operations, you get something like log m p over n bits per operation. So what you do is you locally collect the stuff you have for each processor, compress it, and then send the compressed data to the processors. Now let's see how to apply that for duplicate detection. So we have elements spread over processors. Let's assume we have locally detected duplicates already. And then the red stuff is duplicates, but you, of course it's not so easy to see without already having the red color, right? And a trivial solution would use a trivially distributed hash table where every key is allocated to one processor using a hash function. And then for every element we have to send our keys with U bits to the right place in the distributed hash table. And then we get about U times N over P communication volume. But note that this is also already better than the stuff in the streaming algorithms people and by the communication complexity people who do not have this P here. Just everything is linear in the input size and unusable for really big inputs. Okay, but the U could be fairly big. Say that's a URL or so, hundreds of bits. Can you save it? And what we do is simply using our distributed single-shot Bloom filters. And actually what you do is you are fusing insertions in the query. So you are, you have your local elements, you compute the hash function values, so numbers between 1 and m, and group them by receiving processors, and you compress each of these messages. Okay? And then the receiving processors, they see, there are people inserting stuff here, and if there's more than two other processors trying to insert, then they see a collision, right? And they report back, look, this might be a duplicate. It's not clear that it's a duplicate because there are false positive collisions, right? But this will affect only a small fraction of the non-duplicate elements. That's a nice thing about this. But we have a problem, right? I mean, how should you choose the size of your Bloom filter? There's a trade-off. If you have a small false positive probability, then you have to send a lot of bits in order to give the address in the Bloom filter. If you have a large false positive probability, then there are a lot of things surviving. And actually it turns out that you can do much better by two stages of this. First, you use a very large false positive probability of 1/log UP. And that already filters out a significant amount of data. And then on the surviving elements, you are using a much smaller false positive probability of 1/U. And then only the survivors of that, you have to actually communicate. And then what you get is a communication volume of log P times N over P plus U times D over P, where D is the number of duplicates. I don't see a way to get around that because to exactly verify, you actually need to communicate the values themselves, plus some lower order terms. And the interesting thing is that there are good reasons to believe that in a communication complexity model that really is symmetric and without bottlenecks, there's actually a lower bound of log P times N over P. But I'm not good enough in communication complexity to actually do the math. And if there's anybody in the room who can do that, I would be very interested to cooperate. So we would have a matching lower bound, actually, which shows that this is also interesting from a theoretical point of view. Also note that duplicate detection is somehow the prototypical problem in communication complexity, not something exotic. It's the stuff the community worked on most, but they haven't looked at this model. And the results are very different for the other models. So it's really interesting, I think. Okay, and here's the implementation of this. Needs a lot of tuning, but then you can really win a lot. And since this is theory, I don't want to go into the details. Right, I mean, actually, if there are questions in between, I could take them also now on the concrete duplicate detection, because now I want to move to the next topic. It's not the case, then something completely different. Matrix inversion. So you have an N times N dense matrix. How much time does it take to invert it on a parallel machine? So there has been a lot of work by the theory community in the 80s and 90s. They have given polylogarithmic time algorithms on a PRAM. And that was somehow the holy grail in that time. And it was less important to have work efficiency. And actually it turned out the people were still interested in that, but they somehow didn't get it done, right? They were a logarithmic factor work inefficient. I will tell you the algorithm for that soon. So the practitioners say, for them, log n factor is already completely prohibitive. They, in that community, they talk about 20% differences, right? So they use algorithms that are work efficient, but have omega n time. So the critical path length is fairly large. And actually, if you look at exascale machines that will have billions of threads working in parallel, this means that if you use these algorithms on an exascale machine, you will only be able to invert matrices that are huge, gargantuan, right? And if you look at the top 500 benchmark, which is used by the practitioners a lot, and which does something similar, namely LU decomposition, you will see that they only achieve the peak performance of their machines by maxing out the memory they have. And the running time of these benchmarks has increased since 1990 from a few minutes to hours, because they really have to work on the entire machine to become efficient. So this might actually even be interesting in practice, although it's now a theoretical result. So we have a gap between theory and practice. Polylogarithmic time work inefficient versus omega n time work efficient. Can we bridge it? And actually it turns out that's very easy, just nobody really looked at it. So ingredient one is Strassen's matrix inversion algorithm. Actually, that's a four-page paper from 69, and in the same paper he invented the more efficient matrix multiplication. So that's really great, right? Nowadays, we have to fill 20 pages before we even think of submitting something. Right, so there's a simple recursive formula that tells you how to do inversion. So you can reduce n times n inversion to n over 2 times n over 2 multiplication and inversion. Right? And you can also use that as an inversion algorithm, but then actually you have data dependencies here, which if you fold the recursion out entirely, again give you omega n critical path. So it doesn't seem to help. So now, what about the work inefficient algorithms? They're actually also very simple. They use just Newton iteration. I mean, we probably all know that you can compute inverses by Newton algorithm for just floating point numbers. Only Intel didn't get it done in the 80s, but everybody else could do it. There was this Intel bug, right? That was because they didn't calculate the number of iterations for the Newton method for division. But you can actually do that even for matrices. There's an amazing part for me is that this very simple formula gives you a starting value that guarantees that this converges. And that's the difficult part here. And you need only order log n iterations. But in each iteration, you have to do a matrix multiplication, and that's where the inefficiency comes from. Okay? And yeah, overall running time is then log square n, because you have logarithmic depth for a matrix multiplication. So, but the combination is extremely simple, and I really don't know why nobody observed that. We simply unfold the computation DAG for Strassen log log n times. That gives us a critical path length of log n matrix multiplications and inversions and additions and subtractions. And then everything here is done on matrices of size n over log n times n over log n. And if you apply the inefficient algorithms to these inversions, it doesn't matter because it's a lower order term. Right? And then everything else is immediate. You have log cubed n running time, and you can actually use more efficient algorithms for matrix multiplication than just the school method with cubic cost. Right? So that's basically all we did. The surprising thing that was that this even outperformed the Intel library for matrix inversion on a shared memory machine. And now there were a lot of debates with the practitioners why that is and whether it's due to our polylogarithmic time, blah, blah, blah. But I don't want to go into the details here. But I think for a theoretician, this is amazing that such a trivial thing has not been observed before. And I think that's one of the main things we can look for. Can we find work-efficient polylogarithmic time? That's, I think, a very nice framework for answering questions about parallel algorithms. Of course, besides communication-efficient algorithms. That's another thing here. Okay. Yes, and that's a problem, of course, here. Yeah. Yes. Yeah, right. That's since you asked it, that's an interesting story, actually. So what we actually do in our theoretical paper is that we are doing a constant number of Newton iterations after each of these steps of the recursive thing, and that in some theoretical sense allows us to prove that it's somehow stable. What happens in practice is that if we drop, that as the fewer Newton iterations you do, the better the results. So at least for the matrices that we have tried, apparently Strassen is better than Newton iteration. But the real issue here is that, I mean, this works only for symmetric matrices. That's in theory without loss of generality because you can reduce to symmetric matrix inversion. But that squares the condition number. So for asymmetric matrices, the method is not stable enough. For symmetric matrices, we claim it's stable enough, but it's not as stable as the methods with explicit pivoting. And that may be a problem for really using it in practice. So my guess is if it's symmetric and reasonably well conditioned, then you can use our method in practice. But you have to be more careful than with the traditional stuff. And the interesting observation for me is that Newton iteration is actually bad in practice. It's stable, but it's to get the last few bits doesn't really work in Newton iteration. Because each multiplication reintroduces errors, apparently. And that's something that the practitioners seem to know, but that was completely new for me because theoreticians say, oh, Newton iteration stabilizes things, but that's not so easy. Okay. More questions on matrix inversion? Then I will move on to something completely different once more, graph algorithms. So just as an appetizer, this is an old result by me from 98. So we looked at an average case analysis of a parallel variant of Dijkstra's algorithm. And that was in 98, right? Just when it was the area was already dead. And the paper was also dead. But since 2007, people start to cite it again. Because that's a method you use for, in particular, in the most popular benchmark for graph processing. That's this Graph 500 benchmark. They use mostly BFS, but it tells them, if once you did BFS, please do shortest path. And then on these graphs they use there, this algorithm works great. So everybody uses it. Now it's cited a lot. But with a 10-year delay, right? So it's quite interesting. But now let me move to another problem where the algorithmic stuff is maybe even more interesting. So a natural generalization of the shortest path problem is multi-objective shortest path. So we have a graph. In that case, actually, a multigraph makes a lot of sense. And you have a weight function that is a vector, a d-dimensional vector, right? And you have a start node as before. And for all possible target nodes T, you want to have shortest paths. But what is shortest in a multi-objective setting? You want them to be Pareto optimal. That means that if you have a path from S to T with these edge weights and you add the edge weights, then the label L you get is Pareto optimal. That means that there must be no other path L prime that dominates L, meaning that it's better with respect to all the objectives. Okay? So for example, for this graph, we have three Pareto optimal paths from S to D, although they are four, although there are six paths in total, only three of them are Pareto optimal, and you want to find them. Okay? So actually, multi-objective shortest path has been, there's a sizable community working on it, and one of the more influential papers from 2000 says, now the main open problem is to parallelize this. And then nothing happened until 2013. It's quite interesting to me. So what you have here is, of course, that for single-dimensional sequential shortest paths, there are hundreds of papers. For single-dimensional, for sequential single criteria, there's also sizable work, a small but sizable community. For parallel single criteria, there's also quite some work, but it actually turns out that in particular from a theoretical point of view, this is not very satisfying because you have quite negative results. In the worst case, it's not parallelizable. Right? But we will see that for multi-objective, even in the worst case, we can give quite tight performance bounds. So let's look at the algorithm that's used in practice for multi-criteria shortest paths. And it's actually almost identical to Dijkstra's algorithm, except for two things, basically. I mean, the labels you are storing in the priority queue, they are no longer scalars, but vectors. And then you have to explain, how do you compare elements of a priority queue? And what the sequential papers here do is they basically use a non-negative linear combination of the objectives. And then they show that this algorithm here, that's again Dijkstra's algorithm, right? You take the minimum label from the queue, you scan it, meaning that you look at all the outgoing edges and produce new labels that are potential shortest paths. And if they're actually improving the label on the target node, you add them to the label set of this node. So you're working with sets of labels at each node, and the labels are vectors. That's the main new thing. And this somewhat odd thing that you still use a priority queue, a single-dimensional thing, for doing something multidimensional, and the bridge is this non-negative linear combination thing. Otherwise, it's Dijkstra's algorithm. Okay? And what you then prove is that it's a label-setting algorithm, meaning that a label that you have scanned is final. You will not find an improvement later. And in that sense, this is also work-efficient, right? Now, how to parallelize this? It's extremely simple. Basically, the only change we do is that we remove the only odd thing in this algorithm, namely that you are projecting multiple dimensions to a single dimension. What we say is, no, we don't use a priority queue, we use a new data structure that we call a Pareto queue. And the basic operation on the Pareto queue is that we are removing all the labels that are Pareto optimal. Okay? And then we can scan them in parallel. That's all we do. Once you see it, it's extremely natural and maybe even a more natural algorithm than the sequential one. Right? So let me give you an example. Once more, this graph here. So in the first iteration, we are producing these two labels. In the second, these two labels. In the third, these two labels. And in the, actually in the second iteration, we are pruning this label. So notice this is somewhat work inefficient, right? We only claim that labels that are scanned are permanent, but we might have temporary labels during edge relaxation. That happens here and here and here. And what remains are the optimal labels. So what you can prove about this algorithm is the label setting property. Labels scanned by this algorithm are final. And the proof is actually you take my book on with Kurt and now a third co-author, Martin Diesfelbinger, for second semester algorithms. Look at the proof of Dijkstra's algorithm, the single dimensional thing, and just look very carefully what do you have to change for multiple dimensions. But it's almost the same proof, very simple. But nobody observed this for, I don't know, I think 25 years ago, the first sequential multi-objective algorithms were considered. And of course, that's nice, but it doesn't give you a clear performance guarantee, right? But now comes the second theorem. How many iterations does this algorithm perform? The answer is exactly the same number of iterations as Dijkstra's algorithm. And the proof is also very simple. You define a dependence graph between the labels, where the labels are the labels that the algorithm scans, and the edges are the dominance relation. And this is a graph, okay, and it's easy to see that it cannot contain a node twice. The graph can contain a node a lot of time. We have lots of labels. But a path cannot contain a node twice. And that means it cannot be longer than n. And also it's easy to see that the longest path in this dependence graph bounds the number of iterations of the algorithm. So what we have here is an algorithm. So actually that it can be an exponential number of labels that you have to scan. But the number of iterations is just n. The same as the Dijkstra algorithm. So all the additional complexity by being multi-objective can be parallelized. And that's a really nice result, I think. So the theorem is that if n is the number of node scans, m, so capital N number of node scans, capital M number of edge relaxations, that somehow replaces the small n and m in Dijkstra's algorithm, right? We get a running time, basically this is a sequential algorithm divided by p plus something that no longer, that only logarithmically depends on these complex things, right? And has polylogarithmic factors more than the n. The bad news is so far we only know how to do that for two dimensions. For higher dimensions, the geometrical data structures you need are more complicated. And that's an open problem how to handle that. Okay, so that's three very simple theorems in a sense. That third one throws in some computational geometry. That also makes it nice, maybe making it interesting for other sub-communities of algorithm theory. And we get a quite nice performance guarantee. Okay. So, and actually this can be implemented and gives reasonable speed up on shared memory machines. So that's on a machine with 16 hardware cores, and this flat part is just for the hardware thread stuff that doesn't help you a lot. So let me conclude my talk. So you have seen many simple fundamental results on parallel algorithms, and a lot more of them will be around the corner. The new thing is also that they are needed for practice, and that the methodology of algorithm engineering helps you to actually put them in practice without giving up theoretical research. Communication-efficient algorithms are, I think, one of the new areas that are very interesting. And maybe a more traditional question would be work-efficient polylogarithmic time algorithms in the PRAM model. And then one should also think about whether all the stuff some of our sub-communities are doing are still that relevant in our new times. For example, there are much more algorithm theorists working on sequential external memory algorithms than people working on parallel algorithms. Although from today's point of view, I would say external memory, that's yeah, certainly big data, but only for very patient people. Because, I mean, we are actually doing this, right? We start with the sequential algorithms, and when we say, oh, we can partition a graph with billions of nodes on a 3,000 euro machine. That's great, but it takes 2 days. Which applications are that patient? I guess not very many. And if you do it on the same machine, which actually already has 16 cores for free, it's 8 times faster. And if you do it on a big data machine, you can probably do it in minutes or even seconds. But we have to develop the algorithms for that. So, and finally, you find the details in the paper. I have tried to compile a list of concrete problems that I find at the same time possibly solvable, but non-trivial. And if you solve them, it's probably a very interesting and important result. And they are going somehow, this list is going somehow from rather specific. So I've worked on relaxed priority queues recently, and there seems to be wide open area. Up to very general, like it's straightforward how to formulate a model for parallel streaming algorithm without a bottleneck. But nobody has worked on any algorithms for this yet. And I guess there are dozens of interesting results that you can obtain very easily and that are more applicable than the stuff that's currently done. Same for communication efficient algorithms. Other areas like energy efficiency are also a big question mark where we don't know very much yet. Maybe a more specific thing for the online algorithms people. There are probably hundreds of papers on sequential paging, right? But what if you say, oh, but I have multiple activities going on in parallel. I can schedule them freely. There's much less work, right? Then a large block of things that are polylogarithmic time work efficient. Can you do this? Several important graph problems that strongly connected components are open as far as I know. There are very recent, very nice results on approximate weighted matchings, but they are only sequential. Our matrix inversion, it would be nice to actually generalize it to solving linear equations also in practice in a numerically stable way. And lots of other things. You could replace this full-time text index construction by lots of things like graph spanners and so on. And that's where I want to finish. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Peter, for your talk, opening new perspectives for research. A question I noted down during your talk was, what strategy would you recommend for finding and identifying these problems? Are they obvious in the papers, and where are they published? But it seems the first step would be to read your paper in the proceedings.
Right. I mean, in my paper, I have lots of self-citations and a few non-self-citations, and some of the open problems are formulated explicitly. And you can also very generically ask yourself, oh, I'm working on big data.
Please
can
stay, you? I'm sorry. Please stay. There are important information, pieces of information to be given in a moment.
So what is the problem I'm working on? Are there parallel algorithms for it? That's a very generic question you can ask yourself. And my experience is that in, say, 30% of the cases, the answer is no, there is nothing or almost nothing, and it would be interesting, and it's not completely infeasible. Just do it. For lower bounds, I mean, there are lots of complexity theorists here. I'm not so much of an expert, but I would expect that there are also things one can do there. Generally, where do I get my open questions from? Yeah, listening to talks, reviewing papers, things like that.